Hello everyone, I'm Mert, and like even though it says like only my name in the agenda, it is these wonderful people, these designers and the legal team behind the workshop that really made it possible. So I would like to give a big thank you to them actually in front of you as well. And I would like to thank Legal Hackers and Atölye for this great event, because like I couldn't be participated in the whole event yesterday, but the first two sessions was like a mind-blowing experience for me as well. And I'm looking forward to meet the host, the speakers as well today, if it's possible. And before I start, like I prepared a little joke, so I just want to put that in before I proceed. So like Margaret yesterday says, told us about like how they actually do like UX research and how they actually cooperate with courthouses in California. So I thought of that a little and imagine myself in an Istanbul courthouse, like standing in an execution office, and a Turkish citizen who just lost his car, lost his house, sees me like a box in my head, pretending that I'm a bot, and like, how can I help you? Like, how was your experience? I think I would be get stabbed, and that would be the most quick user experience research ever done. So geography is a destiny. So that's what I'm trying to get at. But it was like a wonderful contributions done by Margaret and by the Amurabi as well. So without further ado, I just want to give a little brief information about Verilogy, and then I'll pass the mic to Yıldız to actually tell about the methodologies that we will actually do in this current workshop. So I'm just going to share my screen. I hope everyone can see it right now. Yep.
Yep.
All right. So after COVID, post-COVID world, like everything is getting more and more digitalized, and the companies that fail to digitalize will actually extinct. And now we see that the awareness around privacy and data ownership is growing more and more each day, even though it's not as much as I personally hope it would be. Still, it's increasing. Like this, like outbreak. How can I say, the WhatsApp privacy policy that we have just recently solved. Like these are good things because like people are getting more aware, and people are actually making companies more accountable on how they handle their data. And we see that because like it's been more than like 2 years now since the GDPR, CCPA, GDPR, and like the Turkish national law, KVKK, went into full effect. And now the companies does not require, like their problem is not anymore, like how am I going to fulfill the minimum requirements set out these laws, these privacy laws. And they, what they really put their thoughts in is, how do I go beyond compliance, and how do I actually create a better experience with regard to privacy, and combine that with my brand, actually, like combining privacy with my brand and providing like a better alternatives to how legal is handled. And this is what we are tackling, actually, because we see that like 270 million of euros issued, millions of euros issued by the privacy watchdogs was fined to already compliant companies. So the current tools that we are using, such as cookie banners, privacy policies, for the last 20 years, are failing to build the trust, especially after this post-COVID world, that are needed to create better relationships with the users and the digital services the companies provide. Therefore, this is what we are trying to change, actually. And what we set out to do is actually, how can we turn legal from something to be avoided, from something to be scared, to a welcoming, intuitive, and user-friendly experience. So like I mentioned in the introduction part, I built various legal tech solutions in the last 3 years, but now this one really, because like the first, when I started, it was more like, how can technology be integrated with law to create like better protections for the end users? But now, for the last 6 or so months, besides technology, now there's this like big opportunity with the design aspect as well. And therefore, now we're trying to combine legal design, artificial intelligence, and actually legal tech solutions together to create this new thing, what we call privacy UX platform, and try to be the, one of the first tech vendors in this category. So just a little brief summary of what we have gone through. So we started with the incubator in one of the biggest banks of Turkey. Then we won a legal tech challenge done by Baker & McKenzie and a Sinat Orhan partnership here in Turkey. And second prize, then we went to TechCrunch Disrupt Berlin. And then we got an investment from Startup Wise Guys and started our Europe operations by creating incorporating another company in Estonia. So I don't want to go too much into detail, but you can always contact me about any inquiries you have from mart@verilogy.com. So without further ado, I want to talk about now what are we going to do with this current workshop. And there were, like I told you, like there are no concrete examples on how this, like what is privacy UX and how we can really implement these in our systems, in our, like if you're a lawyer, in our clients' legal services. Therefore, we thought it would be a great idea to actually provide some concrete examples on what can be done better with regard to privacy and user experience. So I would like to invite Yıldız now for the methodologies that we are going to actually deploy on this current workshop. So Yıldız, please unmute yourself and show your face.
Hello, everyone. It's Yıldız speaking. I want to talk to you about our methodology and our scope in a brief way. So from my experiences as a privacy professional, we face with a lot of problems during compliance projects. And one of the problems is to fulfill the legal requirements, we are offering some changes to our clients. And these changes may also affect some designs on their interfaces and also affecting their users' experiences and mostly in a bad way, because we are not thinking about to improve it. We are just trying to focus on the legal side on it. And on this work, it's not a full compliance project, but we are focusing on improving user experiences in a privacy way. And we actually have three sites, three actors to satisfy on our works. First of them is the business owner, of course, because business owner is the one who will make the change and who will pay for my wage. And also second one is the user. User is also the part of it. And we also need to think about the user experiences. And the third one is the legal authorities. We also need to comply with the law. And to achieve our goals, we actually decided to make three main goals. And one of them is the, of course, fulfillment of the legal requirements. And the second one is the reducing of the negative effects of compliance projects on user experiences. And the third one is to create surplus value for the user and the businesses by making privacy a part of their experience, actually. So there's also business scope of this work. And for the final, I want to make it very clear that it's not a full compliance project. What we will do, we will only focus some areas to improve our privacy experience. So we can move on and start with the workshop.
All right. So before actually we invite Elif to start the first point of inspection, which are the cookies, I just want to give brief information about which actually the platform, which company we are going to examine in this workshop. And the company is called Gamer Arena, and they are an online competitive esports platform where you can match and compete with opponents and teams of your skill level across numerous gaming titles, enter the like esports world, and climb up the ladder all the way through from like a hobby to a professional gamer, actually. So We thought it might be a interesting choice rather than doing some conventional company, because like gaming, it means more teenagers, more university students are inside, and there are more creative ways that we could do. We could actually approach this workshop. So again, without further ado, I would like to invite Elif to kickstart the first session, which is about the cookie experience. Elif, the stage is yours.
Thank you all for joining us today. And I would like to thank Matt for organizing this session and also Yos for making a great introduction to what we will be doing today. Basically, we will start with cookies and then we will go on to some other components of the website as the user's experience goes with their interaction with the website. So let me just share my screen just a second. Okay, I guess everyone can see. All right, so first of all, I would like to talk about what are cookies, right? Basically, cookies, I'm sure everybody's heard about them, but I want to just give you a small explanation. Cookies are pieces of data stored on every user's computer by the web browser. And if we had to make a general definition of what their purpose is, they work as a mechanism to remember the user's interaction with the page. And why are we talking about cookies today in our privacy user experience jam session? Because cookies help the website owner and sometimes also third parties to process personal data of the users themselves. And this doesn't necessarily mean that cookies are bad. It only means that sometimes we are legally required to give the user options to manage the personal data that is processed automatically through them better. So basically, you can have different approaches to cookie banners, which I'm sure you've seen them as users. I'm sure that you heard about them, and if you're a legal professional in data protection, I'm sure you've heard about them. There's no escaping cookies, they're the hot topic. But basically, there are different kinds of cookie banners. And in this session, in the first part of this session, we would like to show you different kinds of cookies, cookie banners that can be utilized by the website owner to become compliant. And we will ask you your opinions regarding them. And we will have a little interaction in the session. So if you have opinions, if you want to say something, you will have the option to do that. But first of all, I would like to invite our designers, Pelin and Enis, to talk about what we did here and what possibly can be done with cookie banners, and what are some designer choices that need to be made in this context?
Hello, everyone. Elif made a very comprehensive introduction to the cookies, and as designers from the community, Enis and I will talk about the user experience side of this privacy UX, and we will start with cookies. So today we can see many web pages that don't respect users' preferences. So they start with preset cookie settings and don't even ask for the consent of the user because they assume that most of the users will grant their consent. However, due to some ethical and legal considerations, we see the importance of privacy-aware user experience design because most of the web pages we encounter each day don't provide a very useful experience in terms of privacy. However, recently there has been a raised awareness in the users. They are totally aware that web pages are storing their data, collecting their data. And although users are aware that they are sharing their personal information, they aren't very considerate about how to take responsibility for their own information. I want to talk about a couple of ways in user experience design and designing cookie experiences that are transparent and ethical. So the first aspect is, of course, providing a more human language, because these documents are written by lawyers in very legal terms. So it's very hard for normal people to read and understand these terms. And using a more approachable language is very important in having users be more considerate about reading them and be more motivated about collecting more information about these issues. It's also important to share with users how and where their information will be sent to. So they also need to be informed about what this webpage will use their information for. Data minimization is also important. So web pages can only ask for the consent of functional cookies instead of some like side cookies that aren't very necessary to collect. In terms of UI, well, we always see that this banner with a more highlighted button on accept all terms. However, it's very misguiding because the designers are kind of leading the users, I mean, force the users to accept this and highlighting that that's the correct choice. However, the users should have the option to also reject sharing the information. So appearance and wording on the buttons is important in allowing user this independence. And after all, the main argument of privacy UX is being transparent to the user, and because users generally know when they are being tricked and it creates a really bad image. So in terms of bridging this gap between companies' legal responsibilities and the awareness of the users, a more transparent experience should be designed. And in tricking these users, companies generally use dark patterns. And you can see examples of this when you're trying to change your privacy settings in terms of cookies. They are generally hidden in like really hard places to find. And now Ines will talk about what dark patterns mean and how they are implied by companies.
Thank you for all. Thank you for your attendance for this wonderful Sunday. I'm wishing everyone to be a happy and healthy Sunday. So I want to describe the dark patterns, which is the tricks that can be that being used in websites and apps so that you can do the things you don't mean to do, like buying or signing up for something. And when you use websites and apps, you don't read every word on every page. You just skim read and make assumptions. And if a company wants to trick you into doing something, and they can take advantage of this by making a page look like it is saying one thing when it's in fact saying another. And there are several types of dark patterns, and I will give a couple of them. For example, Roche Motel is you can get into a situation very easily, but then you find it is hard to get out of it. For example, premium subscriptions and account deletions. Also, there is a hidden cost example. And when you get the last step of the checkout process, you discover some unexpected charges that have appeared. For example, delivery charges, taxes, and this kind of stuff. And there are also disguised ads, and some ads are disguised as other kinds of content or navigation in order to get you to click on them. And that's the dark patterns, and I suggest you to go check out the other examples.
All right, thank you so much, Ines and Pelin, for explaining the design side of this to us. And first, actually, we're going to go into our more interactive side part of our session. And basically, we will be asking you to choose between two designs that we have prepared prior to this session. And we will ask you to choose what appeals to you the most as the user. We ask you to not look at it from a legal point of view or which one is more compliant. You should look at it from a user's point of view and just pick what looks, what would give you the best experience as the user. And you can actually, yeah, you can see, right? I guess everyone can see right now. Okay, so if you scan the barcode on the far right side, you will get to our poll. And for the, if you want to vote for the one on the left-hand side, then you have to pick A. And then if you want to pick the design on the right side, then you should pick B. And we would like to hear from you. We want to know what you think about these two designs. And your time is 60 seconds, and I'm starting it now.
And I will be DJing right now, so. It was a teenage wedding, and the old folks wished them well. You could see that Pierre did truly love the mademoiselle. And now the young monsieur and madame have rung the chapel bell. C'est la vie, c'est the old folks. It goes to show you never can tell. They furnished off an apartment with a two-room in the robot safe. The coolerator was crammed with TV dinners and ginger ale. But when Pierre found work, the little money coming worked out well. C'est la vie, c'est the old folks. It goes to show you never can tell. They had a high-five phone, oh boy, did they let it play. Okay, the time is up now. Thanks, Matt, for the fun break. So basically, we see some people actually gave us their answers on the chat as well. Matt, do you have the results from the poll? Yep, just in a second, I will share the results. And in this phase, actually, if one of the participants want to raise their hand and just give some perspectives on their side with regard to this poll, we could always welcome you to unmute yourself and yeah, share your opinions about
you, what. You can share your opinions vocally if you prefer that, just by raising a hand, and we will try to give as many opinions as possible spotlight. And then otherwise, if you don't want to talk, you can also give us a line. You can just like drop a line on the chat and we will try to read as much as possible on there. Can you tell us why you chose what you did? Why did you pick A? Why did you pick B?
And the results are 77% went for the B option and 23% went for the A option. And if nobody wants to actually speak about it, maybe Pelin, Ines, you could just give a brief. Yeah, I think somebody's.
Oh, we have some in the chat.
So
I'm sorry if I mispronounce people's names. I'm sorry. Yuri Ribeiro, I think. Yuri Ribeiro actually said, I voted for A because the buttons are different. The contrast makes it clear for me that there are two information, two different options to choose from. That's an interesting point of view. I didn't expect that. And Una said, with A or focus immediately jumps on the yes, I accept button. And Esan says, B, because we do not promote any kind of force people to accept it. Both seem to be equal. Martina says, I would like more green color, like traffic light green go red stop. Yeah, we do actually see that approach a lot in a lot of websites. Personally, I am of the opinion that it speaks directly to our, I don't know if it's inherent, but if it's taught, but we assume that green is go and red is stop, something dangerous here. They definitely use that. Sinan says, I'm happy that someone brought this issue finally, also B for the reasons stated above. Oh, Yuri also says, I'd rather have a decline button than a more info. Okay, that's a fair point.
For time management, I think, Ines Pelin, would you like to add anything about what the design approach to this and what would be the effects on the psychology of the end user might be? And then we can skip to the next one. And just for our workshop team, maybe we could just expedite the process a little more and talk a little faster, because otherwise the other parts won't be, I don't think we will have enough time for the rest of the workshop.
Okay, thank you, Mertcan. Actually, B is the more correct side of the privacy and your cookie settings. It's because of the hierarchy of the colors make you select the red one in the first glimpse. So that more information button can't be seen immediately. And as I said before, we actually, most of the time, we skim the text and the buttons. So the correct way of using and for privacy, for transparency, is the B setting. We can go on.
Thank you. Ikin also said, I would like to read this. Definitely, yes, I accept and reject all more information would be better, I guess. These are different choices for design, obviously. And thank you all for your participation. We're going to go on to our next poll, which is going to be the same concept, but different designs. We ask you to choose between the two designs. If you want to vote for the one on top, then please pick A, and if you want to vote for the one on bottom, then please pick B. And your barcode's on the right side. You can scan it and get to the polling website, or otherwise you can also write it on the chat. You can also see those. And
60 seconds has begun.
Yes, started. Our time is up. Thanks for the
weird choice of music. Yeah, it's a Mongolese metal band that I just recently discovered, and I thought, yeah, that they might be a good fit for this workshop.
There's some requests for the playlist, Matt. You might have to share the playlist.
Yeah, we'll do. And the results are for A, 85% said A is a better experience, and only 14.3% said the option, they went with the option B, actually. So again, if any of the participants want to share their ideas through the chat or through raising their hand and talking to us, we would like to hear your opinions on it. Otherwise, any spin, or if you can just share your perspectives as well.
Okay. In the previous example, we've seen that the button sizes are equal, and the design leads user to select with color selection. And in this example, we see that in the first A part, the button sizes are equal and the colors are same. So user has to read both of the buttons. But on the B side, we see that there is a little text for the more information. And this only leads user to speedily accept the cookies.
Thank you. We have some opinions also in the chat. It looks like Kakash said there's basically one option in example B. It appears like that, doesn't it? It looks like you can only accept it at the first sight, especially if you're going through it really fast. If you want to get to the content, you're more likely to just click whatever's in front of you. And yours says on B, reject options too small and hard to see in the background. It doesn't really look like a button clickable. And Akin says in A, users are aware of the two options and can make a more informed decision without being misled. And Akin actually has a question. I was wondering if there was any research on difference between putting yes on the right or left on left in different countries. Say in reading from left to right or right to left countries. I think that's a great question from a design point of view. Do you know any research in SNPDN regarding this on putting the yes and no on different sides?
Actually, I encountered this kind of situation previously. And one of the website designers said the analytic tools give the designers the bad statistics because of the alignment of the buttons, just because the left to right, right to left reading and writing situation. So, but I don't know any kind of research now, but there must be some.
I agree. I think, and it's like there's definitely a difference between two individuals who live in different countries using different sides for as a default, like right or left side. From my perspective, I think the one on the left would be more the prime choice, the primary, the first thing to choose, and the second was the second thought. And that's an interesting point of view, though. Like, thanks for bringing it up, Akin. And Aipir says, I directly understand that in the first option, I have the option to not allow. Obviously, yeah, that's a great point. And Yuri says, I believe there's also a difference between Android and iOS users for that. I didn't know that. Maybe there is. I don't know if that is a concern from the design point of view for apps. I don't know about that. Thanks so much for participating in this question. And we're going to go on to the third and final question for the cookies part of the session. And the concept is the same. You have two different designs. You have one on the left, you have one on the right, and you can scan the barcode on the right side or right on the chat if you want, if that's more comfortable for you. And please pick A for the one on the left and B for the design on the right hand side. And you have 60 seconds to do so, and your time starts now. Hands up. Fade out was a great, great effect here. Thanks, Mark. Okay, so what are our results?
Typeform says no signs of movement. So either nobody, share the response on Typeform, or I think we're having technical difficulty. Regardless of it, please share your opinions on the chat, or again, unmute your mic and just speak your mind. Otherwise, Elif and Enis and Pelin, please share your opinions on it. But let's keep it like 2 minutes max, so that we could carry on with the other parts of the workshop.
Yes, please. Then I guess we don't have the results from Typeform then. Please, if you voted already, please restate it in the chat so we know what you think.
So I'll start as answers continue coming. I saw some comments about legibility and aesthetics. Well, the main difference between these alternatives is not the UX, but the UI. So the first example provides a more approachable communication language to the user. And the second one is more technical, and it only provides the information in a very direct way. Although in this one, there isn't a correct answer. Well, the first one is more aesthetically pleasing. So the users may tend to read this and spend more time skimming this banner, while the second one doesn't attract that much attention. So it may lead to the user just ignoring all this information and clicking accept and continue.
Thank you, Peyton. Okay, we have some comments. Some people like the design on the right better, and some of them liked the one on the left better, obviously for different reasons. And B has no color hierarchy, therefore neutral. Maybe that might have appealed to people better. And yours says, I voted for A, but actually changing it to B, I like colors, but the controls in the background makes it difficult. Yeah, it might be difficult to read because of the text being the same color as one of the controllers. Okay, Abdullah says B. Yeah, Yura has says I probably missed the advertising purpose because you can't read. Yeah, that's possible. Iber says I understand that I have to make a choice because of the color difference. Senai says A looks more fancy, easy to follow. Esan says A is more trust building. It feels like the company is responsible and behind the policy. Well, actually the main difference between the two, like the incentives between the two designs, was that one of them relates more to the content of the website itself, and the other one is actually more blank, more like a legal text that you just have to click away to get to the content. Yeah, A is basically unreadable unless because of the color schemes, it can be a problem, yes. But the main point was that if you relate the text, if you make the cookie banner a part of the website itself, it can actually contribute to the experience overall. But obviously there are other things here to consider than just the context. There's also like the color schemes and stuff, obviously. Well, that's understandable. Okay, guys, thanks so much for your input for this part of the session. We will now move on, actually, to the privacy policy part.
I just want to give a little brief disclaimer while you set the privacy policy part up, Elif. So, like, nobody's in this workshop is really having any commercial benefits or anything, and everybody's like either part of a startup or like working in a compliance legal team and get their hands really full. So it was really hard for us to bring all these different people from different geographies, from different countries together and create something meaningful. So please, how can I say that word? Don't go too harsh on us. We will actually make these designs much more bulletproof. But today we just wanted to, due to the lack of time, we just want to give you an idea of what might be the different things besides. And we actually plan to write a detailed case study report about the game arena and the topics that we have and not mentioned in this workshop as well. And we really please reach out to us and contribute in that case study report if you'd like to. So I just want to give that little disclaimer to all. Elif, please carry on.
Okay, thanks. Well, Serpil said no correct answer. I mean, basically, I want to say based on this question actually, that there are no good or bad answers to the, like, that's how we programmed this. Like, we didn't actually want there to be an obvious choice and one is the right one, so to speak, and the other one's the wrong one. There's no such thing in this. It was based completely upon user experience, and we wanted you to also have input and tell us what you like, basically. So thank you all for your answers. There's no wrong answer here. Everything's the right answer. Now, you said when it comes to cookies, I like having a turn on off options on the banner for each cookie tag. Yeah, that's usually what comes after you click more information. Obviously, it can be like directly, like automatically that as well. That's a different commercial or design choice, I would say. Thanks all again for your inputs into this part of the session. So we go on to the privacy policy part of the session. Basically, first of all,
I'm so sorry to interrupt again.
Oh, go on.
Please excuse me. Perhaps like for this privacy policy part, we should finish this in 7 minutes. So so Enis, Pelin, and Elif, I'd like you to go a little more quicker for this so that the other parts really can be inspected.
Okay. All right. You're right. Okay. Well, let's first talk about what's the privacy policy. And I actually want to first talk about what it isn't, because we see a little confusion as to what it is not. A privacy policy is not a legal contract. It's not a transaction. It doesn't have parties. So if you see in policies, by doing this, by using this website, you do this and that, that's not necessarily part of it. It also isn't a disclaimer. It's not something that you can waive your rights and responsibilities through. A privacy policy is a declaration. In the privacy policy, a data controller of in many legislations, I would like to say, I don't know if data controller is the main theme in all data protection legislation, but everyone knows what I mean, I'm sure. The data controller in the privacy policy should introduce itself and its data processing activities. That's basically what it is about. A policy's exact content can be different based on what legislation the data controller is trying to comply with, honestly. But what it also doesn't have to be is long and boring. You don't have to have a privacy policy that is unreadable or just a bunch of legalese that people just want to click through. It can, as long as it has the requirements set out by whatever legislation you want to comply with, you can actually have different designs. And I think, and we think collectively, that we can actually improve user experience based on how we make this privacy policy look to the end user. In this session, we're going to have our friends Pelin and Enis talk about how they redesigned the privacy policy for Gamer Arena. And we would like to hear from them in this session. So the floor is yours.
Thank you, Elif. According to the Article 12 of the European Union regulations, privacy notices have to be intelligible, concise, transparent, and easily accessible. And the accessibility concern brings about the need for UX design to bridge companies to users. And most users of privacy policies feel overwhelmed by the sheer quantity of the information in them. And the legal design isn't just a nice to have thing in the context of privacy, but it's a must to do and regulatory imperative. And most of the lawyers know that when it comes to legal drafting, it's much harder to concise than wordy.
Well, however, most of the current privacy policies we see in web pages consists of long and wordy texts because companies don't actually intend users to read these policies. However, the design of these legal documents don't only serve for visual motivations, but it also helps users become more aware of these policies, and it actually reduces the risk these companies faces. So in that sense, it's important to be transparent about the content, and visualization plays an important role in motivating users to be more curious about these policies. And the more user-centric approach is necessary in bridging the company regulations to the users. In the slides, you can see a redesign of a privacy policy page in Gamer Arena. And the first one, it's very direct and kind of boring. It's a very long and wordy text. However, in the redesign, you can see the necessary information split into categories and explained in a flow so that you can easily find the information you're looking for. And it's in visual sense, it's more enhanced and it's more engaging. So users would want to spend more time looking at it, reading it, and having more information about it.
Thank you so much, Inspirin and Elif. Now we carry on with the last two parts of the session, which are more about the transparency and the user journey inside the game arena. And it will be more visually attractive. I mean, these were also attractive, but they will put more emphasis on the real legal, real user journey, how a user interacts with the platform actually, and how could we enhance the user experience while also covering the legal requirements. So the floor is Gülbike's, I assume. Yeah, Gülbike.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm going to start with why it's important for user experience and why we are making human-centered privacy design. Privacy-aware design framework, most commonly known as Privacy UX, is a rational approach that goes deeply into designing ethical and respectful user interfaces within your existing business processes, such as data collection and privacy interactions, as you know. Suspicious cookie policies, content prompts, meddling, push notifications, third-party tracking are some of the many factors behind your increased bounce rate. You need to find ways to optimize your opt-ins in order to minimize risk. A privacy-aware UX not only provides just an ethical, transparent, and human-centered experience, but also encourages trust among users to opt in and consent to your marketing activities. So we're gonna redesign Gamer Arena's interfaces in terms of privacy UX. So we can start with sign-up screen if you're ready, Fatih.
Yes, hello everyone. I am Fatih Serhan, and I'm honored to be with you here today. I am sorry for video camera because I am connecting from the browser, so I couldn't start my video camera. So before starting to our real-time designing session, let me introduce myself a little bit. I am a UI and UX designer with over 5 years experience in this field, and I am trying to create user-friendly journeys and user interfaces, and currently working as a digital experience manager at Turkcell headquarters, which is the also first digital operator in the world. So as a team, our today aim is increasing your awareness about how we can use the law approaches and perspective to build better design and user experiences. As you see, we are going to focus on the Gamer Arena journeys, and we will start from the sign up pages to the settings pages. So maybe we can start with this form. But before that, maybe we can analyze this page with the low perspective with Yoz.
Sure. Hello again, guys. On our this phase, as our team members said, we will focus on user experience and design, on real-time design. And on some phases which we will look at, there may be some legal problems, or there will be just user experience differences. So Our first screen, as Fatih told us, was the sign-up screen. On sign-up screen, you can see that it's asked for your full name, email address, username, password, and your date of birth. First, when we land on this page, we first noticed that it's asked for our date of birth, and there's no explanation why it's asking for it. So I couldn't be sure about it, so maybe I thought it could be an idea to notify people how to do how we are collecting their data and why we need their date of birth. You may say that it can be in your privacy policy, but we, while we are trying to improve our privacy experience, we may thought that it could be nicer for people to see them on board while they are giving the information. So Fatih, what could we do about it? Could you just move on?
Yeah, maybe we can ask a question to our participants. So also they can answer from our chat. What do you value more while signing up? A, transparency, B, time.
Will we have some music, Marcin?
More mellow.
Yeah. We have a lot of A's and B's, so people have different choices on this. So what could we change here? How can we just improve our transparency without taking too much time from them?
Yes. Maybe Ludwig again could give some brief about the solution we are going to make. About the sign-up form. Gülbike, do you want to give a short brief?
Okay, on the sign-up page, the terms of service and privacy policy should be separate, and users should be able to evaluate and mark them as different documents. So we have to provide different checkboxes for them. Also,
Gülbike, I'm so sorry to interrupt. There's this white noise in the background, so those who don't talk, can you please mute yourselves? Thank you.
Thank you. Also, we provide question mark icons for users to inform them about why we are taking this information from them, and also how we're going to use these data.
Okay, so let's make some designs together. So for my microphone also. yeah, this is our current design, and according to Gülbike output. So first of all, we can make the name and surname optional, for example. So we can write here, this input can be optional. And then now we are taking the birthday. Instead of, we can say that, please confirm your age. And also we can place here a question mark to make an awareness for users why we are taking this information actually. So let's put here an pop-up. So yes. So let's say that why do we need to know your age? Yes. This can be one of the And also we can write here some informative text, but now I will make dummy text. Yes. Yes. If the users want to learn and know why we are taking their age info, then they can click this question mark and then we will inform them. So as you see here, we are taking three agreements. So we can divide into two. And as you know, it is coming with the check it boxes. So firstly, we can take it here and make it not checked. And in the first section, we are going to take only terms of service agreement. And so for this information, we don't need to ask again because we are taking the information of the age here and then just say that I'm checking this box to agree the policy. Yes, I think we can redesign this sign up form like this. What do you think? Gülbük, do you want to make a comment about our this redesign sign up form?
It looks more transparent and also give user more information about its the data's usage and what our participants think about that. Maybe they can use checkbox comment or we can go to the other symbol.
Okay. I also wanted to speak this time. I'm not gonna write it. I think it's more useful for me because I hate to write every time my name, my birthday, etc. And this, it's very simplified and makes me wanna do it even more.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your
comment. Ethan would like to talk about
the age of UX then.
The point of having a second box for the privacy policy.
Hi, thanks. I just have one comment. I know that you actually explained it before, but why do we have this second box for the privacy policy? Because these terms and service and privacy policies are the text which user cannot actually negotiate with the company. So what's the point of making two different boxes instead of one?
Esen, let me answer that question. First of all, GameBrianna is not a great example for this question, but because here GameBrianna is not asking for any consent because there's no need, there's no legal need for it. So maybe your question makes sense here, but we're trying to focus on design. So it could be also another website which would need a separate consent about their privacy. So that's why in general we prefer to separate them.
I believe that was a great explanation, and I want to say regarding that also, I think it might be confusing to say that I agree to the privacy policy, because as I've talked just a little bit about, it's not an agreement. It's not something that user can negotiate with Gamer Arena. So it might be better if we reword it to, I read this, I understand this, rather than I agree to it. And then maybe a sense of question will also be answered.
Exactly. Thanks for contribution, guys. That's great comments. So are there any questions or should we move on?
So I think we can move on.
Okay.
Let's come to our second screen.
Second screen is a landing page. Here, I want you to focus what you don't see instead of what you see. Because that was the idea. On most of websites, when you signed up and when you get in, you don't have any information about what your current privacy settings are. Most of them, they're pre-marked and they don't even notify you about your current privacy settings. And most of websites, as I told you, are making decisions for you, even if they give you the chance to change them later. So we thought, how could we improve our privacy experience here? And the question is, how important is it for you? So the question is, after you sign up, would you like to see your privacy preferences first? Or would you directly dive into the website? Music, please.
Dominique, Nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu. Il ne parle que du bon Dieu. À l'époque où Jean sur terre d'Angleterre était le roi, Dominique, notre père, combattit les albigeois. Dominique, Nique, Nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu. Il ne parle que du bon Dieu. Certains jours, un hérétique par des ronces le conduit. Mais notre père Dominique, par sa joie, le convertit. Dominique, Nique, Nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu. Il ne parle que du bon Dieu.
I think I am stuck. Yes, yes.
Yes, we can't hear you.
Yes, yeah.
Sorry, guys. I can see that most of answers are A, but some people say that it's unfortunately B, or it depends on the media. People are right, because the gamer arena is not a data-oriented website. So most of people may not care about it, or people would prefer to dive into the site first. But we are trying, to, as I told you before, gamer arena is just an example here. So in general, we are trying to improve experience. So it could be also a social media. So Fatih and Gülbike, how could we improve this area?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I want to take the comments of Gülbike and then I will make some designs for this solutions. Yes, Gülbike.
On the onboarding screen, when the user first logs in the application and platform, there is no information about how to use the application, and also it don't give a chance to the user to check their current permissions and change them. So we have to give these informations and also opportunities to the users.
In the onboarding section, we can do lots of things, but now we are focusing on the, how we can manage the preferences and give information about these preferences to the users. So let's assume that this is our homepage when I after the sign up. So before seeing this page, I think we should. There's a problem list.
Sorry for interruption, but I don't know if it's just only for me, but if everybody's hearing the same. Your audio quality has dropped significantly. So my suggestion for you might be just exit Zoom and then come back in. Maybe that would fix things up in the Turkish way. Just close and yeah.
Hopefully. Yes. Now I think it's clear. Yes, good. Thank you. So this is our homepage after the signing up. So Now we are focusing on the how we can give the preferences to the user as an informative way. So let's make it something darker here to make a focus for the people. And yes. So let's place and pop up again here. So for the time concern users, we can place here and close option. And let's use some informative text here. So we are saying that welcome to the gamer arena, and let's say that. Let's choose your preferences, and you can also change your preferences whenever you want under profile settings, and let's place some preferences as taken default. For example, Gamer Arena is a desktop application. It's not a mobile application. So generally, the notification sends from the emails and desktop notifications. So to not catching some important information, then the default settings is calm, like to send me notification by emails and allow desktop notification. So we can make an informative pop up here, and if there is a change, then we can place, so if we make any changes, then we can say that save my preferences, and also we will give an information to the users whenever they want, they can change it. So if you are time concerned, then you can close this, and after the you're joining to the Gamer Arena, and you can go to the settings page and you can change whenever you want. So I think according to answers, we can redesign this onboarding process like this.
Okay, let's move on then. Our next area will be chat. On Game Arena, it's a platform which you can talk with the community. And one of the first aims of this area is actually keep the community together. So on their current situation, they are just giving opportunity to send messages public. So there's no private message option. So we thought that it might be disturbing for people. So let's ask to you guys, would you find it disturbing to only have an option to send your messages public? Or would you prefer private chat as well?
Ja, was geht denn plötzlich vor mit dem lieben Theodor, seit er reingetreten ist in seine Ehe? Immer ist er aufgeregt und zum Streiten aufgelegt, doch zu Hause ist er still und trinkt nur Tee. Liebe Leute, er hat heute mir ganz heimlich erzählt sein Wiwi. Sag ich blau, sagt sie grün, sag ich her, sagt sie hin, sag ich komm, sagt sie just am Ende, ich bleib. Sag ich ja, sagt sie nein, sag ich raus, sagt sie rein, ach, mich bringt zur Verzweiflung das Weib. Aber plötzlich wird das Mäuschen still und da mach ich alles, was sie will. Sagt sie grün, sagt sie blau, sag ich blau, denn sie ist die Entzückung.
Perfect fade out. Okay, vast majority of the answers is it should be optional. People think that it should be optional. So one team, Zülal Erdoğan, says that they don't care, but there's no one who finds it disturbing. So could we make it optional, Gulbika and Fatih, as people prefer?
In the chat view, we should include a permission screen that will enable the user to decide whether to make their conversations public or private. And we have to give them a choice. Also, we should state that users can manage their settings in the privacy settings section in this pop-up. We're gonna focus that in next screen.
Thank you, Gildika. Let's move on to design this chat section. So this is our chat section in a redesigned way also. So we will see the redesigned chat section like this, but we say that we can make an here an informative pop-up before sending the first message, and then we can ask the people, do you want to make it public or private? So let's do like this and ask them about the chat settings. So we can place here two buttons for the users, and we can make it optional also for the users. Do you want to make it public or private? And if you're not sure, you can choose one, and then you can go to the settings page and you can change it. So according to, I think, the our survey answer, we can make like this approaches in design. Yes, is there any comment or any feedback? Yes, why using green and red? We can change it also, of course, but generally we want to create a community in the gamer arena. So make it public is our primary selection. So if it is a private, then also it can, it will not be contribute to our community vision. So we ask the gamer arena, which is your priority? Then we placed the primary button as in green. That is the reason.
Yeah, we are also concerning about business purposes here, as we mentioned in the introduction. So not only privacy, because user privacy is not the only thing we can think about. So this section looks perfect again. Thanks, Fatih and Gulbike. Let's go to our settings. So I want to ask a question to everyone. Do you think something is missing on current, not this question, Fatih, first let's us see the page. Yeah. Do you think something is missing here? Let me give you like 15 seconds. And do you see anything missing here? No one. Yeah, delete profile. Perfect. Yeah, there's no delete profile. Also, there's no general privacy settings at all, actually, including deleting profile. So even, for example, our first team mentioned about cookie settings. When you get into a website, they're asking for your preferences first. And then when you choose your preferences for the first time, then it disappears. And they don't give you any opportunity to change your cookie preferences or other consent preferences. So maybe we thought it could be a good idea to make a privacy section here, privacy settings, where you can change your consents, cookie consents, and other other privacy settings. So Fatih and Gulbike, let's move on.
The say for users to leave and manage all privacy settings, the privacy settings section should be included under the heading of settings, and users should be informed about all their permissions and why these permissions are taken from them, and how these pieces of information beneficial to them in return. So we can make a redesign about it.
Okay, before that, I want to learn an idea about the general settings difficulties. So maybe a music can be good here, Mertcan.
All my exes live in Texas, and Texas is a place I dearly love to be. But all my exes live in Texas, and that's why I hang my hat in Tennessee. Rosanna's down in Texarkana, wanted me to push her broom. Sweet Eileen's over in Abilene, she forgot I hung the moon. And Allison in Galveston somehow lost her sanity. Dimples, who now lives in Temple's, got the law looking for me.
Okay, Fatih, people find it difficult to change their privacy settings generally. So let's solve this problem for Gamer Arena.
Yeah, let's make it easier than the current version. So let's take our current screen. So as you see, there is uncommon settings, profile, games, and notification. Under the security, there is only password and block. So we can start to redesign our menu section here. First of all, we can place a general settings and privacy settings into two groups. So under the general settings, profile, games, social accounts, and blocked user, and then we can expand our privacy settings with notifications, cookies, and our consent, and lastly, the email settings. So firstly, let's start with the notification. So as we mentioned in the first session, we make an pop-up here, for example, let me show you. And on the onboarding section, so we take some preferences from the user and we say that you can reach them to our profile settings menu. Then when the users come to here, then they will see their preferences saved. So we can also manage the cookies, for example, let's make it quicker. Yes. So also we can place the cookie settings before signing up. Many people try to answer the cookies they will accept or not, but whenever they want, they can also change from settings. Let's change its status also. And we can close it. And consents also, they are very important. So in some reasons, the people cannot understand what are the consents. So in the settings page, we can make it more informative. So if we believe that the information is not very clear, we can place a question mark near to that information. And when the people click to this question mark, they can take more information like we make here and here. So pop-up can be very useful in this cases. So lastly, the email settings, for example. And as you know, many platforms ask for our email preferences. Generally, we become a subscriber of that email marketing, but then it can be very difficult to leave that subscription. So in this Gamer Arena, we want to also make it reachable and easier for the users to change their email marketings. So if a user given permission that for that marketing emails, and also they can change they want or not, and the frequency also can be reachable under this settings page. And lastly, and one of the missing section here is, I think, stored data. So also we can make a section like here, and you can give an information to the users, what do you want to make with your data. So we can say that you can download your data or you can delete your account. So actually the first settings page were like this, but now we expand the all kind of settings and give a reachable and easier way to the users whenever they want to change their settings. So if there's a change, also let's put in here our button and save updates. Yeah, I think we can manage this settings page like this.
It looks perfect.
Thank you.
Hassan has a comment, but I couldn't understand what you meant actually. Could you just raise your hand and connect us verbally?
I can't speak directly because I was already allowed to unmute myself. Okay. So what I'm saying that, like, you know, the platform might change and there might be new requirements or new settings which you might offer the user the ability to again turn on and turn off some of the settings. So when you have now you have like constant settings, then the email marketing settings, and then you might need add to another kind of settings, right? And over time. So if you add all these kind of settings on top of each other, then the list getting longer and longer and longer, and the user will need to spend more time on this page and turn on and off each settings individually. And I think this will become very overwhelming in the, you know, over time. So my question is, like, how do you plan to overcome such an overwhelming list of things?
Hassan, I think it's a perfect question, and to be honest, I never thought about it. And when you mentioned it, I think it's a real problem. On this case, we had not that kind of situation yet, and in my other works as well, we haven't faced that kind of situation yet. But this could be the situation, and we may, when we face that kind of problem, we need another solution, user-friendly solution. I don't have a direct answer to this, but I really appreciate this question. I will think about it personally. But
maybe we could make them collapsible so that if you just want to change something about your cookies, you only click the cookies and the settings regarding the cookies only appear below and the other ones remain closed. You could make it like that, I think. It's a great question though, because personally, I really like having a lot of settings. It makes me happy to click settings and there's like a lot of different settings rather than a few things, but it can be an issue for the average user, the person who just wants to change a specific thing and not like the entire thing. So
by the way, as the lawyers like to speak a lot, Fatih is doing something on the background. So he's probably solving the problem which you asked for now. So probably
yes.
He's making different sections to read it and understand it easier.
Yes. According to amount of the data, we can make a full list like in this approach, or if we believe that our data vary too much to read for the users, we can manage in the subcategories. So in this approaches, we make the general settings and privacy settings main and only section. But if we believe that our data is too much for the users to manage, so then we can divide it into subcategories. So we can make a focus also. When we come to the notification, we see all only the notification. So cookies, if we laterally want to expand this list, and also we will have enough spaces to manage the upcoming informations. So it can be another approach. Mm-hmm.
And also maybe you may add a button to decline them all or accept them all, so which could make their job easier.
And this will be the first workshop in the world that creates real-time solutions with design and legal combined. So thank you, Fatih, and Yus for your contributions. And the great Sam as well.
Thank you, Fatih. Thanks for showing us all like how you do it in the background. It's a great experience just to see it being made, in my opinion.
Thank you so much. These all screens will be shared in our case study also. So if there is any comment, we will also take in a response from the chat, and then we will include our case study. So thank you for your attention. Thank you so much. Now I leave the stage to Mertcan.
Before closing it, I really want to thanks to everyone, every participant, my teamworks, and our participants for joining us in the Valentine's Day, in the Sunday, in a perfect snow in Istanbul. I don't know the other cities, but thanks everyone for joining us. We love you, privacy lovers.
I'd like to thank all the participants who given their thoughts, shared their perspectives. You made this workshop really much more valuable with your inputs. So thank you, participants. Thank you, the great team behind the workshop. I really, really, really can't say enough. You like not making love to your girlfriend on this Valentine's Day and sharing your wisdom with all these people from across the world. And prior to that, actually spending like a week or two working on this, besides like all your hassles going on through with your personal lives, I really want to thank the team behind the workshop. And a special thanks to Bilgesu. Actually, she was going to be on the legal team today, but yesterday night she went ill and she said, I won't be able to talk because her throat really got severe pain. So special thanks to Bilgesu for all her contributions. We wish she could be here as well. And yeah, I mean, like this is something that we are trying to build this community, what we call privacy active. So not only legal, designers, security researchers, academicians, PhD students, etc. So please keep in touch with us. We have a LinkedIn page called Privacy Active. We're gonna get the Slack platform up and running as well. And we'll actually continuously and regularly do these kind of reports, because as I told you, there are no concrete examples on privacy UX. So hopefully we could contribute on this subject with this like collective thought that you just witnessed and real-time solutions that, yeah, like I really got goosebumps in that scene. So thank you, Fatih, Yıldız, Pelin, Enis, Gülbüke, Ahmet.
Mertcan.
Yeah. Me.
Don't forget our silent workhorse, Ahmet, because he is a silent guy, but we should appreciate his work as well on the background.
Yeah.
So Ahmet with us as well. Thanks, Ahmet.
Hero in the shadows. Yeah, Ahmet, thank you. Yeah. Congrats, team. Congrats. And that's all for us. I hope you all a good, nice, cozy Valentine's Day with the ones you love, or even yourself. Which, yeah, we must love more than everyone, I suppose. Cheers, goodbye.